Good evening. We continue the series that we started a few weeks ago, and today I believe it's number 6, if I remember correctly, of the Pirkei Avot. And Baruch Hashem, we get a lot of great response from people who watch it in the website. So I had a feeling that people would like it, because it's words of wisdom of Chazal, which every Jew needs to know by heart, not only to hear once in a while. This is things that every kid has to know. So we finished last week, we finished the second chapter, and today we're starting the chapter number 3. Altogether there are 6 chapters in Pirkei Avot. The last thing we said last week was that the obligation of every Jew is to learn Torah, not to finish the entire Torah, to learn, to put his efforts. Obviously, the more he does, the better it gets. But there's no obligation, oh, you did 100 pages and you did 200 pages, so automatically you get double. It doesn't work that way. That's maybe in college. But when the Torah, it's based on the effort. So if a person said 10 hours and his friend said 10 hours to learn, and one did 10 times more than the other, doesn't make a difference. As far as the reward, there's no difference. Yes, he has more knowledge, because he's more talented, maybe he was born with a sharp brain, fine. But the efforts, that's what determines the reward. So this is how it goes. So today I'm starting the third chapter, and the first Mishnah in the third chapter, it starts like this. Akavya ben Mahalalel Omer. It's all the names of this Tanaim. Some of these names may sound strange to us, even to the Israelis, because it's very old names, ancient names. Most of these names nobody names anymore. But you should know that every name that is mentioned in a Talmud, that means that this rabbi was in a level that not only that he knows the entire Torah by heart, the Torah, the prophets, the Kabbalah and everything else, they were able to take a dead body and revive the person back to life with their knowledge, to bring back the soul into the body. That's how great they were. If they were not in this level, their name is not mentioned in a Talmud. So every name here, when you say the name, it's already a mitzvah. For instance, I know some people before they go to sleep, after they say Shema, they say Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Akiva, just say this name. It's already a holy name. It's already a mitzvah. Just saying a name and falling asleep with words of holiness. Okay, so Akavya ben Mahalalel say, Istakel b'shlosha dvarim ve'e ata ba'i ledvar avera. Watch, pay attention to 3 things that will prevent you from making any sin. 3 things. What is it? First, you always have to know and remember where you came from. Where a person came from, we'll see in a minute. Where are you heading to in the end? And who are you going to report and to be judged in front of? Where do you come from? One drop of liquid, a person become from a drop. Nobody ever imagined that from a drop, all of a sudden you have a person, he's thinking, he's talking, he's remembering. So many interesting things that he comes from nothing. And then, where are you heading to? Eventually, we all will end up in a grave when the worms will eat the body and the snakes and all the other things that inside the ground. They come and they eat everything. They leave nothing. So a person, by remembering, who am I? I'm a Mr. Big Shot. I'm on top of the world. I'm the President of the United States. Whatever I am, in the end, I'm really nothing. Because if I was something important, I was something important forever. The fact that I will be ended up as a food for the worms has to remind me never to be proud. And who are we going to be judged in front? In front of the kings of all kings, HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Once a person remembers the 3 things, where I came from, where I will ended up in, and who am I going to be judged in front, right away all his ego go down to 0. The problem with the people that they forget that. That's why they get offended. Oh, they didn't give me, they didn't respect me, and I deserve better, and you know, etc., etc. So the second Mishnah, Rabbi Chanina says, always hope and pray for the kingdom of the place where you live. You live in Israel, of course, you pray for the Chachamim, they are in charge, this is the kingdom. But what happens if you live in Russia or in United States or in England, anywhere a person lives, a Jew? Always hope that the kingdom will be strong. Why? Who cares about the kingdom? I care about the government of the United States. Sure, I should care. Why I should care? Because if they will collapse, people will eat one another alive. In 1 hour, it will be the end of the world. Which means, I give you an example, if today they come on a television and they announce that for 1 or 2 hours there's a strike, there's no police, no court, no nothing. For 2 hours, whatever you want to do, you can do. No punishment, no judgments, nobody see, nobody, police doesn't accept any report. Whatever you do in these 2 hours, you are dismissed from any punishment. You know what would happen? In less than an hour, it will be the end of the entire world. It won't be just a damage to the United States, you know, 1,000 people got killed. No. Once everybody will know that now there are 2 hours opportunity to take revenge against all my enemies, those who I hate, those who destroyed my life, every person will go right away to take revenge. So it will start with millions of employees that just got recently fired from this company, from that store, from this business, right? Some people will go to kill the doctors that they did not diagnose their cancer on time. Because of them, they're going to die. Some of them were going to kill their ex-wives. Some of them going to kill, who knows, their in-laws. It's going to be a disaster, the neighbor. So since everybody will be killing everyone, and all the minorities, all the poor people in this country will rob the stores, they break the glasses, they rob all the supermarkets, all the electronic stores, all the jewelry stores, no police, no nothing. The stock markets all over the world will collapse. People would lose all their money in 1 hour. What's the point? They worked 40 years to gain all these millions, and in a minute it all became zero on the screen. They'll jump from their buildings. That's going to be the end of it. Then when people would see that that's what happened, somebody that works for some military base will go crazy. Even today, every week you hear about somebody went crazy and started to kill innocent people just because he's angry. Just imagine what's going to happen. Somebody will shoot like 10, 20 missiles with atomic bombs, that will be at the end of the world. So it sounds crazy, but it's very realistic. 1 hour you leave the people alone, that's besides all the accidents on the highway and what's going to happen because there's no police. So the Gemara says, always hope and pray for the kingdom to be strong. If they go down, you go down with them. As much as you hate them, you need them. They are making orders in the streets. You know, I heard in Chicago that two Congress people made a vote that you must send troops to Chicago. Soldiers. Why? The police cannot handle the crime there. The economy is bad. When the economy is bad, many people begin to steal because they don't have enough money to bring to their kids. And they begin to rob and steal, and there's a lot of crime. The jails are packed. The court has no time to take care of it. The only way to do it is to put thousands of soldiers that they see military troops all over the city, they think twice. Other than that, they lose control. So that's what the Gemara says. Ish et re'u chaim bla'u. They will swallow one another alive. It's an expression. There won't be even time to kill one another, like you swallow your enemy in a minute. Rabbi Chanina ben Tardion says, two Jews who sit together, they eat together, they sit in a table together, and they do not discuss words of Torah. It's like a combination of bunch of clowns. It's like clowns getting together and speak about jokes and nonsense, even if they did not say one joke. Not necessarily they have to make fun at people and say some jokes to laugh and to drink some beer. No, this is needless to say. They just spoke about business, they spoke about whatever they want. The fact that they gathered together and they didn't think it's important enough to say a few words of Torah in a table, like we always try to do today, that shows that these people are more to the clown side than to the holy side. Then, two who sit and they have words of Torah between them, they do have. Then once they speak Divrei Torah, the spirit of HaKadosh Baruch Hu come to listen, and Hashem writes every word of Torah that goes in between them as a memory in his special book. Yikatev b'sefer hazikaron, in a book of memory of Hashem. How do we know that even one person who sits and learns Torah has nobody to talk to? He's alone, sitting at home and learning, or in a shul, alone. Because the Torah, the prophet says, Yeshev badad ve'idom ki natal alav. He even sits alone and learning, even quietly, he's just reading to himself, he's still going to receive his reward. Why? Because every activity of Torah right away makes the place holier. Rabbi Shimon says, three that eats in one table and did not say words of Torah, it's like eating dead bodies, God forbid, like dead animals, nevelot. Why? Because the goal is always spirituality, not just eating. That's the idea. And three that sits in a table and say words of Torah, it's like eating from the table of Hashem. It's like being a guest of Hashem in his own house, just because they mentioned the name of Hashem, the spirits of Hashem come down on the table. Rabbi Hanina ben Chachinai says, someone that is up in the middle of the night and walk in the streets. Now you have to remember, the streets 2,000 years ago wasn't like today. You have beautiful sidewalks and neon lights and you know, and activity and cars, and you know, it's a different world. In the old days, if a person would, once it become dark, if a person would walk in the middle of the night, it's mamash a life risk. If you know, if you go to certain places, it's like forests, some trees, that bad animals, snakes, scorpions, robbers, all kinds of things. So walking alone in the street after it became dark, it's a life risk. So the Mishnah warns, someone who walks alone, and also someone who makes his heart empty from holiness, only nonsense goes inside, הרי זה מתחייב בנפשו, is risking his life. So they're actually comparing a person who walks in a forest in the middle of the night, that there could be robbers over there or bad animals, to somebody who sits and learns nothing. All he cares about is news, you know, college, where would I get my college degree? Okay, maybe important, maybe he's looking for a job, I'm not saying no. But the most important thing that a person has to remember, that the purpose that Hashem put him here is to know as much as Torah as possible. That has to be the center of the life of the Jew. We see that it's the most important thing to Hashem. The creator of the world is very proud of us, his children, that we are busy with his Torah. Otherwise, what's the point? He did not bring us just to eat and sleep like the monkeys. And even the goy, it's interesting, a goy is not obligated to learn Torah. But the Gemara says that a goy who sits and learns Torah is like a Kohen Gadol in Bet HaMikdash. A goy, imagine some Russian guy in Russia, or some German in Germany, or Chinese in China, sits and learns Torah. I once read an article about one goy in Austria. One goy in Austria. And that goy in Austria, all he does, he makes wine, that's his job, he sells wines. And besides the vineyards that he has, all he does is sitting and learning Gemara. Go in Austria, sits and learn Gemara. He knows the Gemara, he knows the names of all the rabbis. He enjoys to learn Gemara. That's his thing, this goy. You understand? So somebody like this, the Gemara says, if he sits and learns Torah, it's like a Kohen Gadol. Then we continue. It says like this. Rabbi Nechunya ben Akana says, Kol amkabel alav ol Torah. Someone who devotes all his efforts to learn Torah, all the other errands and problems that ordinary people have pass away from him. Which means, every one of us, we have to go sometimes to the doctor, to the motor vehicle, traffic, doctor's appointment, children, psychologist, this, that, all these things. Every person has a lot of waste of time, right? Has to go here, has to go there, he has a meeting there. Someone who decides that from now on, I don't care about anything in my life besides to devote all my time, and the center of my life is the Torah. I don't care about cars, I don't care about clothing, I don't want to waste time, I don't care about cooking food, it's cold, it's hot, all these things I don't care about. Really, I want to be a real great servant of Hashem. So automatically, Hashem saves him from all the ordinary problems that ordinary people has. And I saw it in my own eyes. We have in Yeshiva all kinds of learners. Some are very serious, and some not so serious. The one who are not serious, it's also a great thing. At least they learn a few hours a day. Better than to be on a beach and making scenes, no? But there are some that they have such willpower that, you know, you can never attract them to do anything besides learning. While they're eating, they're learning. When they go to bed, they fall asleep while learning. When they're in the yeshiva in the lunch break, they eat 5 minutes, right away they run to the book. Nobody forces them, but they love it so much, they don't want to waste a minute. Let's say Friday afternoon, some of the yeshiva goes to play in a park, soccer. You beg them to come. No, they always make an excuse. You come back, you see they sit and learn. They give up all these things. They don't care about it. They already reached such level. Sometimes I follow these people. I give you an example. Sometimes a person go and buy a brand new car. It can be 1 year old. You still smell that it's almost came out of the factory. From the minute he buys it, every month problems. One day has to waste by the mechanic, another problem, little accident, 3 days the car is in the garage, and again, an oil change and this. I knew one guy that loved to learn Torah so much, now he's in Israel. He bought an old car, you would never believe that this car can drive. And before he had the car, the person who owned it before has tons of problems. For 2 years he had the car, not one time he went to the garage. Not one time, nothing. I did not have to touch the car. As soon as he moved to Israel, he sold the car to another guy. Every week he's in a garage. This is just to give you an example. Why? Hashem said, you love me, you give all your heart for my Torah, I save you from all these little agonies and pains that I send to people, you are dismissed from that. Even to get a license, he was about to go to the motor vehicle, somebody told him, you don't have to. Give $15, there's one guy, he goes, he will do everything for you. In the last minute. So I say to him, I was wondering how Hashem will waste half of your day to go to this lousy place and stand there online. Now I got my answer. So you see, people like this have special protection. That's called all malchut ve'ol derech eretz. Same things if he has a little business. All the other problems that people have in businesses, he automatically gets saved from. What? Anyway, I'm not interested in that. Hashem, I just want to eat. Give me a piece of bread, a mattress to sleep. I'm happy. So, the whole idea is that Hashem always reminding us, don't be overexcited from this phony world. You fall in love with that, you get addicted to materialistic thing. Hashem always reminds us, that's not what I put you here. Hey, it could be convenience, but you are not here for that. Pay attention, whenever you order a brand new furniture, always it's going to come with some damage. Scratched in the last minute, one of the legs is a little bit crooked, the piece fell. There's always has to be something. Why? Why is it you buy a $10,000 piece of furniture, it's gorgeous, it's beautiful finishing. By the time the movers brings it in and all that, all of a sudden you see something bad, you need a touch-up. Or it's not what you order. Why is it? Because the people are so excited from this phony life. They think, wow, that makes me happy. And Hashem gets so upset that Jews go so low in their level that a watch makes them happy, or a suit, or I don't know, any kinds of gold bracelet, or even flowers. It's such nonsense that when a person gets so happy from this nonsense, that shows that he's very empty from inside. Because a person who loves the Torah never cares about what kind of watch he has, as long as he tells the time. Pretty, ugly, comfortable, name, not name, or the tie. Like today, you see it's the kids in yeshivot. It's not what it used to be. Cannot lie to ourselves. The kids today in yeshivot and the kids 30, 40 years ago is not the same. How do you know? When kids meet each other, the first thing they do, they check. Well, I have a better one. Let's already show you that this kid has no future. Why? Kids in the old generation, they could wear the same suit for all year. It will never bother them. In the Torah, by the way, one of the things that Hashem impressed the nation of Israel with is that they did not have to change their alphabet for 40 years. That's praising them. Not, it's not a derogatory thing. If you tell a person, for 40 years I'm wearing the same suit, Rabbi. 40 years, every day the same suit. I said, this guy's crazy. It's not normal. He's antique. Don't marry him. He's not. But in the time of the Torah, when Hashem could give them anything he wants, bread is falling from heaven, everything. What did he say? Simlatcha lo balta. Your clothes never wore off. You know, it was always still complete. So there was no reason for you to change it. So we see when a person has to change his clothes, when it's not useful anymore. It's full of holes, it got ripped, or he grew up, it's not his size anymore. Okay, now I have to buy a new outfit. But before that, what for? Just because I'm bored from that color? That's emptiness. That's emptiness. I know I'm speaking at a very high level, and I just want us to know how far we are from the ultimate truth of Hashem. What important for Hashem, what important to our rotten society is completely two opposites. But the idea is, how long are we going to stay losers? That's the question. Do we want to do something about it, or we want to let our life pass 70 years pretending that we are religious, and in the end, we are not even in the first level. So, someone who devotes all his time for Torah, Hashem release him from all the other obligations in life. But someone who tried to get rid of the difficulty of learning Torah as much as he can, for instance, they offer in a yeshiva, we need a volunteer to go bring the food every afternoon. There's always going to be a foolish guy who jumps. Okay, I'll go. Why? It's 20 minutes break from learning. To learn is difficult. Oh, I have an extra 20 minute break. I drive the car, I go around, I see some people on the street. I always told my student, why are you the one who brings the food? He said, mitzvah, no? I help everybody. I say, no, no. Tell me the truth. Did you really volunteer because you care about what the guys here will eat? Or you only do it because it's another 20 minutes to rest? If you really love the Torah, you would never ever agree that to get up for 1 minute. Because you know the reward that you're going to lose for every minute, just because you do a small mitzvah to bring some food, there's always going to be a volunteer. Why you have to jump first? When you don't want to volunteer, that shows you love the Torah. Because for every other thing, you will never volunteer. Any other thing, you would never volunteer. For instance, if you'll be sitting collecting money now. Let's say they put you in a room and you collect as much as you want. There's millions of $100 bills all over. Collect as much as you can. And they now need a volunteer to go bring the food. Would you leave the money and run bring the food? Of course not. What happened to the mitzvah? What do they eat, the guys? You don't care about the guys right now. You're collecting $100 bills. Learning Torah is much more than collecting $100 bills. Then Rabbi Chalafta Ish Kfar Hananya says, 10 who sits and learn Torah together, Shechina Metzuya Beneihem, the Spirit of Hashem is among them. Sheneemar, Elokim Nitzav Be'adat El, Hashem is Adat El. How did they learn that the word Ada is 10? From the Meraglim. Ada means a group of Jews. What happened if it's 5? What happened if it's 3? Even 2? And as we said, even one, each one who learns, there is an X amount of Spirit of Hashem, Shechina comes to that place. Rabbi Elazar ben Ish Bartuta says, Ten lo mishelo, give him from his, Sheata veshelcha shelo, that yours, right, and everything that you have, it's his anyway. Which means Hashem gives each one of us parnasa. We make a living. Each one makes an X amount of money a month. We have an obligation to give minimum 10% from the net, even 20%, depending how strong you are in faith. So some people, when they give, wow, I sacrifice so much, it's very difficult, how am I giving so much? So the Mishnah says, give him from his, anyway it's his, you're not doing him any favor, he asked you to give. So give him from his, because you and everything that you own, it's actually his. Right? And it also it says with David HaMelech, Ki mimcha kol u miyadcha natanu lach. Everything is from you, And whatever we give you came from you anyway. Right? Never to forget that. Somebody walks in the street and learning Torah while he's walking in the street and stop because he saw a beautiful tree and he say, what a beautiful tree Hashem made. Somebody like this deserve a reward or a punishment? What do you think? Person walks and he learns Torah, he goes in his mind, repeats what he just learned in Yeshiva on the way home, he's walking. Then he saw a beautiful, nice tree in the spring, and he said to his friend, let's say, wow, look at this beautiful tree, how Hashem made such a beautiful tree. Right away he said, beautiful, he's praising Hashem for the creation. That's for somebody who does nothing, it's a mitzvah. But for somebody who learns Torah to stop a minute from learning, even for that, it's a loss, not a gain. So somebody like this, is mamash risking his life. Of course, we exaggerate a little bit. It's like an analogy. Stopping learning Torah for anything in the world, even to such a thing, needless to say, for stupid things. How much was the game? Who won in the middle of the Torah? Who got elected to be the new prime minister? You know, that's already obviously. So they give you an extreme example that even to stop and praise Hashem and be impressed from His creation, you're not allowed. Everything else is needless to say. Rabbi Dostai, the Rabbi Anai, it says in the name of Rabbi Meir, someone who forgets his Mishnayot, he learns all the Mishnayot, and then he forgets a Mishnah, also is risking his life. What's the connection? Because the Torah says, be very careful and watch your soul very carefully that you will never forget the things that your eye saw. Which means, sometimes people learn and then they neglect what they learn. They don't repeat. And then after a year, you don't remember anything. You're learning. Somebody comes to a year later, no, what's the story? I don't remember. What do you mean? You're 20 years in Yeshiva, I don't remember anything you learned. So the minimum is to repeat everything we learn at least four times. Four times. If you don't learn four times every page, you will not remember. But if you want to remember it for the rest of your life, even 8 years later, to know everything by heart, you have to learn 101 times. It's a secret in this number. That's King Solomon told us the secret. You want to learn and never forget? 20, 40, 50 years later, somebody wake you up at 3 o'clock at night, what is the Mishnah in Brachot, chapter 2, the second Mishnah? Right away you tell him by heart. 8 years later, why? You learned it 101 times, you will never ever forget it again. Since obviously we're not in a level to learn everything 101 times, even though there are some people who does it, but ordinary people do not do it, so at least four times minimum to have good understanding and memory about it. Then Rabbi Chanina ben Dosa says, "Kol she'irat chet'o kodemet lechochmato, chochmato mitkayemet. Ve'kol shechochmato kodemet li'irat chet'o, en chochmato mitkayemet." Translation, there are two things about the person. One is his wisdom. And one, his irat shamayim, his fear from Hashem, which means how he keeps the mitzvot. When you see a person that knows a lot of Torah, but is not so careful keeping the mitzvot, all the Torah that he knows, for sure one day will drip and will be lost. If a person doesn't know that much, but everything he knows he keeps very strictly, even everything he's going to learn will be kept by him. Why? What comes first? What's more important? Knowledge? Or to translate the knowledge to actions? If a person knows so much Torah and in the end, he speaks all day Lashon Hara, he eats not so strictly kosher, you know, he does all kinds of bad things. Where exactly this Torah is bringing him? The idea is that how do you know if a person will have blessing in the Torah that he learned when you see how he behaves? Shulchan Aruch says that if the teacher that teach you Torah is not a decent person, you're not allowed to learn Torah from him. So if you know about one person who gives a shiur, that is messing around with ladies, or is crooks with money, he cheats people in business, you know, let's say he also works and he has a business, and he's not an honest person, He cheats his customer, he gives them warranty and doesn't respect his word, he tells them it's brand new and he sells something that's not so new, he's shaming the Jewish religion when a goy comes, he makes chilul Hashem, and then in the morning, after the prayer, he gives a shiur in the shul. No, don't learn from him. There's no blessing in such Torah. Why? Because Hashem says in the Torah, וְלָרָשָׁע אָמָר הָשֶׁם מָה לְךָ לְסַפֵּר חֻקָּי. Hashem said to the wicked person, who put you here to teach my laws? I'm not interested in you. Since Hashem is upset from him, even the Torah he teaches no blessings. So we gotta be very careful who we're learning Torah from. Because believe me, there's a lot of fakers out there. That's why we look the way we look. So the Torah, the Shulchan Aruch said, תלמיד חכם שמידותיו רעות נבלה שרוחה בשוק טובה ממנו. Someone who knows a lot of Torah, but his behaving is horrible, he behaves bad, he cheats, he steals, he's lazy, he's saying bad things about people all the time, he's jealous, he's greedy, whatever, all the bad things that a person can have. Nevela srucha, which means a dead rat in the street, is already better than him. Why? The dead rat has no free choice. The rat is dead, it's dead, it stinks, it's not his fault. But he stinks because it's his fault. It's a difference. If it's your fault or it's not your fault. You understand? Nobody ever got punished from being born ugly or short or anything or with a defect. Nobody gets punished for that. You get only punished for something you chose to do bad. For that you're responsible. So, the idea to keep the Torah that you learn is to live according to what you learn. If you learn like it's in college, Rabbi, I'm not in court right now. I'm a lawyer. When I'm in court, I behave like a lawyer. Now I'm a clown because I'm with my children. Fine. With laws, it can be. He's a doctor in his office. When he's home, he can be whatever he wants. But with the Torah, it's not two different categories. Whatever you learn, that's how you have to be. If you learn that there's mitzvah to be generous, you have to be generous. So mitzvah not to be jealous, cannot be jealous. If you know that you have to fear Hashem and Hashem is watching you every second, you have to live accordingly. If you have two different lifestyles, only here, when you're in this town, when it's all religious people, you're very religious. Then one day you go to Puerto Rico, you fold your beard, you put a baseball cap, the next thing they find you on the beach with all the Puerto Rican naked ladies. What are you doing here? You're learning in yeshiva, no? What are you doing here? No, we need some rest sometimes. It shows that he's rotten from his foundation. Because it cannot be that a person will be religious 2-3 months when he's in one place, and every time they go on a show to Vegas or to Hong Kong, all of a sudden he becomes a goy. It shows you that even when he's in a religious town, he's rotten. It's all a show. A person cannot change his identity. That's what it says. The prophet says a sentence, it's very famous in Hebrew. Hayafoch kushi oro venamer chaburotav. Can a black person replace his skin and become white? No. The leopard can change the skin, the color of all these stains that it has on his body. Cannot change. So that's how Hashem cannot be changed. Same thing, a black person cannot become white or white become black, or the leopard cannot become a bear. Same thing here. If a person is a tzaddik, he's a tzaddik everywhere. If you see him once in a while that he's not, or sometimes you see religious people that they do all kinds of insurance frauds, tricks, you know, UPS tricks, they got the package, they don't report, they already collected insurance. So when you say to them, hey, what are you doing? It's against the Torah. I say, hey, Torah, it's in Monsi. Now we're in Manhattan, we have to make a living. That's, you see, this person is not religious, it's all a fake. If you're religious, doesn't matter where you are, you have to be honest, no matter where you are, whether you're in China, whether you're on the moon. You don't touch something without permission. Stealing, it shows you not, it's all a fake. I remember one time, one supposedly religious guy came to me to sell me life insurance. But not for me. He didn't come to sell me life insurance for me. To sell me life insurance for an old man that he knows, that people buy a policy and they are the beneficiary on the life of this old man. So what's the trick? He say, buy life insurance on the old man. In his ID, it shows that it's 70. They made a mistake. He's really 80, but they do not know it. When he came from Europe, they made a mistake in his ID. They changed the date by 10 years. So I know him. We know the family. I know he's 80. You know, we even know his son. He has a son that is almost 60, so he cannot be 70. But you know the difference buying an insurance on a 70 years old and on an 80 years old? In 7 years, you'll pay $300-$400 a month. On 80 years old, it can be $2,000s a month, because that's it. He's already one leg already in the next life. So I told him, but I don't understand, but it's fraud. You're stealing money from them. So he looks at me and says, why? It's their problem, they do not know. I say, well, I showed you that it's fraud. So now in 1 minute, I don't know, maybe he was pretending that he's shocked. Maybe he knew all along and he was still doing it on purpose. He looked at me like he was speechless. He couldn't say a word. He's going from one person to another, selling them insurance. I told him, wait and see. In the end, this old man will bury all the people who bought policies on him. He continued to live for many years. Everybody prayed for this old man to die. And Hashem said, you know what? The more you pray for him to die, the longer he will live. Why? That's how you want to make your money on another person's sorrow and pain. Then, here is another interesting say. Kol sheruach habriot nocha mimeno. Every person that everyone is comfortable with. Nobody hates him. Nobody speaks lashon hara about him. Nobody has anything bad to say about him. Somebody like this automatically has good points in heaven. Even if he's not the most righteous person, just the fact that you can never find one person on earth that has something bad to say about him, it helps him a lot. On the other hand, somebody that almost every other person has something bad about him, even though he keeps the mitzvot, the fact that you have so many enemies already make your situation not as good. You know, one guy, he came to the rabbi. So, Rabbi, I was introduced to this girl for shidduch, to get married. What do you have to tell me about her family? They live next town. So the rabbi said, go to that town. When you come off the train, the first person you see on the street, stop him and ask him about that family. Whenever he tells you, that's what you do. If he tells you it's good family, marry her. If he tells you it's bad family, take the train and come right back. Don't even meet her. Rabbi, whatever you say, I do. He goes on the train, he gets to that town, he comes off. You know that family? First person who knew them, right away he told him, oh, what a great guy, the father, I love him. It's a great family, great girl, everything is perfect. So he went, he got engaged. He likes the girl, everything's fine, they got engaged. Just when he got married, a week after, every place he goes, people told him, you're the one who married her? Wow, poor guy, what a mistake. How did you do such a mistake? You know how many shidduchim she was offered, not one person wanted her? So he said, why? What happened? He said, her father is the biggest crook. You know how many people he stole their money here? Everybody hates him here. It's such a crooked family. So he went crazy. Wow, look at me everywhere I go. So he ran quickly to the rabbi. So rabbi, everyone in town knows that they're bad. You know everyone. For sure you know they're bad. Why you didn't warn me? So the rabbi told him, I know that this town has thousands of people. And I know that everybody in that town hates this family. Except one person. There's one person that is just as bad as them, and he loves them. Min matzat mino. I say to myself, what is the chance that from all the people in town, the first person you're going to ask if this family is good or bad will be that one? What's the chance? 1 to 10,000? If from all of the people in the world Hashem send you that guy to tell you that they're good, you have to sleep very well at night. Why? Because you know you are one of the only people in the world that can swear that they married the right soulmate. No doubts here. No doubts here. Something like this could be coincidence. So Hashem wanted you to marry her. Now go and check yourself why you ended up with this family. You understand? What, the bad people don't have to get married? They have to get married. With who? With bad people like them. That's what happened. It's been always the case. So,
So he continues and says like this. Rabbi Dosa ben Harkina says, Shena shel shacharit, over sleeping in the morning, waking up very late, drinking alcohol, wine, heavy wine, in the middle of the day, and sitting and playing with the kids, wasting your day, and sitting together with all the ignorance in the shul. They don't come to shul to pray. They come to talk about ha and da. The vacation, the business, what store you open, what store, what stock to buy. You know these old people that sit, they don't know two words in Torah, but every day they come to shul, they look like such tzaddikim, but the only reason they come, it's like an old age club for them. They come, they bring newspaper. Good thing they don't bring cards to play inside. You know, if the rabbi wouldn't be there, they probably would do the same. So it says, somebody who oversleep, wastes his time waking up 10, 11, 12, whatever, sitting with the ignorance, drinking alcohol during the day, is destroying his life. Motzi'im et ha'adam min ha'olam, wasting his entire life. You know, I knew a guy that wasn't religious, but he was very, very successful in everything he touched, even though he was a crook, was a liar, he was deceiving people, he was a pretender, everything. He was a Rashi Khan artist. But he had success in his businesses. You know why? At 7 o'clock in the morning, he was already in his office. Secular people are not such hard working. They like to sleep. If they can, they sleep until 12, especially if they went up the night before. So once in a while, you see a hard working guy that is not lazy, that is waking up very early. This guy, no matter what, 7 o'clock already was in his office. A hard working guy. So he saw results in his work. Most of the people, especially in America, most of the stores, they don't open 9, 9:30, 10 o'clock. In Israel, 8 o'clock, the store is packed with customers already. 8 o'clock in the morning, businesses are open, most of the places you go. If you're working for an office, for a company, officially it started 8. Same thing school. Some schools start at 7 in the morning. You know, in order for you to have blessing in your efforts in life, I'm not talking Torah and mitzvot now, talking ordinary business, it's very important to start the day early. You start the day early, your day will be blessed. You start it very late, you see that you would not be successful in anything you do. Then, someone who disrespects Chol HaMoed. You have first holiday, second holiday, in between you have Chol HaMoed, which means he works as usual, he doesn't care, he doesn't pay attention to the halachot in Shulchan Aruch. And someone who takes the sanctified sacrifices, the kodashim, and touch it with impure hands and make it tameh, make it impure. And somebody who embarrassed his friend in public, in front of people. Why are you lying? I saw you there. No, it's not true. You're not, it wasn't you, it was somebody else. All kinds of things like this that you hear all the time. Oh, you gain a lot of weight. What happened? Since you got married, I see you eating a lot. Things like this that may look like a small joke sometimes can destroy a person. Or someone who making sex crimes with the ladies and doesn't watch his covenant with Hashem, Brit Milah. And someone who modified the Torah according to his convenience. It's allowed. You can steal from the goyim. Who told you you can't? Only from a Jew is a vaccine. I never steal from Jews, only from none. All kinds of lies that they make to make their things, to justify their sins. Even if he knows a lot of Torah, which means he learns a lot of Torah. If you don't learn, you don't know. Even if he does a lot of good things, he has no share to the world to come. What? What for? Disrespecting Chol HaMoed, because he says, it's a weekday. Look, we're allowed to drive, we're allowed to use electric. So what's the big deal if I go to the business as usual? What's the big deal? Right? Someone who embarrassed other Jews in public, sex crimes, modifying the Torah and saying wrong things for people that you want to use. I mean, if you have an agenda, you want to read something, so you're twisting it according to your agenda. Even if he knows a lot of Torah, and he does a lot of positive things, it would still take away his world to come. It's a big risk. Especially, someone who embarrasses his friends in public,
He has no shelter to the world to come. Ke'ilu shofech damim. It's like spilling his blood. If you embarrass the person, what happened to him? He becomes very red. What's the connection of being embarrassed in your heart to become red? In your face. You don't become red in your legs. You don't become red in your hands. You become red in your face. Why? Because the blood cells, the red blood cells in the skin, under the skin, they all explode. And what you see, the redness is really blood. If you didn't have skin, it was all blood coming out from the organs, from the system. Just the fact that you embarrass a person can cause the blood to go into the face and explode. That's how bad it is. So that's why they say it's like spilling his blood. Ke'ilu shofech damim. Almost finished this perek and we'll finish for today. We're almost done. Rabbi Ishmael says, you have to be קל לראש, I will explain, ונוח לתשחורת, והווה מקבל כל אדם בשמחה. What does it mean? Make yourself always available to help important people. If there's a rabbi in your area, he came from Israel, and he doesn't know the city, he came to collect for his yeshiva. Don't wait until he comes to you Motzei Shabbat and beg you if you can pick him up and take him to his place. You have to run to him and say, listen, I know that you're here and you don't have transportation. Can I lend you a car? Or can I drive you for an hour or two? Or if you get stuck somewhere and you need help, if you need help, I don't know, whatever. You have a suitcase, you have a place to sleep, you need addresses of people, maybe I can help you. They're giving you some of my rich friends that you can call them, maybe they'll help your yeshiva. So by helping people like this, that shows you care about Hashem. It's not, you're not doing it to get something from Him. Anyway, He cannot give you anything. It shows that you really love Hashem. So, then, Noach letishchoret means, it's even though you're an older person, and there's somebody very young that knows Torah more than you, usually the older people get offended if the young people get more respect, right? If somebody is 60, 70 years old and they give respect to 16, 17 that knows a lot of Torah, you know, like Rabbi Ovadia Yosef in his 20s already was a big judge in court. In his 20s. When he was a kid, one time he came from the yeshiva and all the briske, the biggest Talmidei Chachamim of the briske yeshiva with their big rabbi, which was a giant, they came out of the yeshiva on Shabbat, they were all walking with the rabbi. And the little boy, Ovadia, was walking in the street. Little boy, yeah, teenage. So I asked them, he was always asking, what did the rabbi say? What did you learn today? They always wanted to learn. So they told him, wow, we have a big question. We're breaking our head already for a whole full day. The rabbi asked this question, and we're trying to see how the answer is going to be. So he told him, it cannot be. That's a clear Yerushalmi. Gemara in Yerushalmi, this page, it's speaking about this question and giving the answer. Right away, he told them the whole page by heart. His brain like a computer. So he got very angry. Who is this little boy? He knows the Rebbe, the big chief Rebbe. He didn't know that. He made a big deal out of it in Yeshiva. In the end, it's a whole page. So what? Even the biggest Rav in the world, some pages, they forgot. They don't know by heart. What, we angels? We're not angels. When he was a kid, some of the biggest rabbis were very old. When they saw him, they used to rise in front of the whole audience. Why? To show them this is the new giant, even though he was a kid. You know the story that one day he disappeared from the yeshiva for 3 days. And his father, he had a grocery, a little grocery. So his Rosh Yeshiva, Rav Ezra Atiyah, was a Syrian rabbi, very holy man. He saw that Ovadia is not coming to yeshiva for 3 days. So he ran to his father's grocery to ask if he's sick. Then he sees he's cutting cheese. So what are you doing here? I told him, you know, my father is alone. He cannot run the business on his own. I have to help him. So he came to his father. He said, well, you're taking your kid out of learning Torah to help in us. You couldn't find another solution? He said, no. I cannot afford to hire another person. You can help me. I'm an old man. I cannot do it on my own. So the rabbi told him, don't worry, send him back to the yeshiva every day, I come to work for you. I work for you. He took his sleeves up, I help you in the store. Then after an hour that he was there, all the customers from this neighborhood saw their big Rosh Yeshiva standing cutting cheese. they started to scream at his father, "What are you doing?" His father Yaakov, his name was. "What are you doing? You're making the rabbi cut cheese. Ah, we're not going to come." So he said, "Okay, rabbi, forgive me. Go back to the yeshiva." And that's how he saved him. And today he's the biggest rabbi in the world. Just think about what would happen if you go and stay in a grocery. One time, he broke his two legs, and one very big rabbi went to visit him in the hospital. He was in his 20s. So they told the rabbi, we know to go and visit the patients in a hospital is a very big mitzvah, but compared to learning Torah, there's nothing to compare. You go to make one mitzvah and you lose a million. The time that you're going to go and travel there and this and that, you lose a million mitzvot to make one. That doesn't make sense. So he told him, even though I do not know this guy personally, I have an obligation to go visit him. So why? Say, because I heard how he broke his legs. It clears to me that he's going to be one day the most important Talmid Chacham in the world. Clears to me. So Rabbi, how do you know? Well, you have Ruach HaKodesh? You have a vision? He said, no. Common sense. How did he break his legs? In the yeshiva, you have a ladder. You know, the books sometimes are very high, all the way by the ceiling. He cannot reach. So he has a ladder, he climbed on the ladder, and he took the book. Now he doesn't want to go up and down, so he stays on the ladder, and he reads two or three pages that he needs to read from that book. So he stands on the ladder, he reads, he goes so deep into the learning, thinking. When he finished, he put the book back and he started to walk. And he fell from the ladder and he broke his two legs. So he says, somebody that can stand on a ladder and learn Torah and forget that he's on a ladder, that shows that he can go so deep into the Torah, it's not a regular person. I have to go visit him. He was right. 6 years later, you saw the results. There's many other stories. There's not the time now for that. Rabbi Akiva says, Schok vekalut rosh margilim le'erva. Being a joker. Always want attention to say jokes that people would laugh at everything you say or do. Make you automatically following all kinds of sex crimes with the ladies. Somebody wants to be the clown of the gang. It's eventually will end up making scenes with the ladies more than another person. Margilim et ha'adam le'erva, because the attention, when it comes from the ladies, the man is more satisfied than when some of his friends giving him some attention. Oh, so this girl was laughing, that girl was laughing. The next day, a week later, you see him making scenes with them. Okay, so a person has to know, yeah, here and there you can say a joke. I'm not saying you have to be cold as ice all your life. But you make it an addiction that all you care about is this. Everywhere you see, sometimes in a class, it's the nightmare of every teacher. There's always one or two clowns in a class that ruins the entire year. Why? They need attention. So they always try to make everybody laugh. Then, ma'asrot siyag le'osher. You want to be rich? You must make sure that you give at least 10% of your net income from all sources out of your territory. Give it out. If you don't, then don't complain why you're not growing and there's no blessing in the money that you make. Siyag means a watch, to watch something, to guard it, to make a fence around it. Siyag la chokhma shtika. You want to be wise, you want to be smart, don't talk too much. Talk only when it's necessary. Keep it short, to the point. Sometimes a person calls you in three sentences, you got the problem. Sometimes a person talk to you 20 minutes to say one little question. You try not to be rude, you know, because then the people, they don't understand that the rabbi already understood the question in less than 10 seconds. But they want to talk. Sometimes it's not about the question, it's about somebody to listen to them. Just to talk, you know. I know one rabbi, he puts the phone down and he makes them think that he's listening to them and he sits and learns. Because he already got the question in the first second. As soon as they call, he already got the question. But they talk and they talk, so he doesn't want to cut them short. Then they get angry. So in the end, as soon as the noise in the phone stops, he picks up the phone, he answers the question, they're very happy, both sides are happy. You understand? Same thing in a lecture. Sometimes you have a guy,
As soon as you say something, it goes like this. The speaker is experienced enough to know what the question, because it's been already hundreds of times in the past. Every time he spoke about that subject, right away somebody jumped in that word. So he already know the questions. So he said, okay, what's your question? So the guy's starting to say the first two, three words. So he said, okay, I got it. But always, you see, the guys never stop. He continue to talk. Why you don't trust him that he got it? Save time for everyone. Why are you wasting now 2 minutes until you finish the entire question? He got the question already. People likes to talk. The more you talk, the worse it gets. Just focus on what you really must say. By the way, you should know that the Holy Book says that a person has X amount of words that he can speak in his life. If he finish them earlier than expected, his life getting shorter. So you have to know, if you're supposed to say a billion words in your life, don't talk too much. Like this, you live longer life. Talk non-stop. Age 60, Hashem calls you back. Hashem, what? I just became a grandfather. You couldn't give me 10, 15 more years? Like almost everyone? You finish your words, that's it. You want to be a 15 years mute here? Hey, I can make you mute. Don't worry, you understand? So this is the idea, not to talk too much. Then, Chaviv Adam Shenivra Betzelem. Every human being is likable, is Hashem likes him just because he was created in Hashem's spiritual image, not physical image, spiritual image. That means every person in the world that was created have something spiritual in him, even the Goyim. Betzelem Elokim Asayit Adam, as the Genesis right in the beginning, that's what it says. Chavivim Israel, but the nation of Israel have extra specialty. They are even more liked by Hashem. Shenikreu banim lamakom, because the Torah said that Hashem told the nation of Israel, you are my children, and he never said to any other nation in history. And banim atem Hashem Elokechem, chavivim Israel, is another reason why Hashem liked the nation of Israel more than he liked all the other nations, because they are the one who sits and learns Torah all the time. So automatically, by sitting and learning Torah, automatically Hashem has special desire for you, that he likes you more than somebody who doesn't. Sheneemar, ki lekach tov natati lachem torati al ta'azovu. I gave you a great wisdom, do not leave my Torah even for a minute. I think that we will finish here now. We did almost most of the chapter today. The next week we will start Bezrat Hashem about the free choice. It starts here, this Mishnah. If Hashem knows the future, how exactly it works for us. This is what he's speaking about. It's a little bit longer than the rest of the Mishnayot. We'll keep it for next week. Bezrat Hashem, Baruch Adonai L'Olam, Amen V'Amen.